Well, good evening, Sizzlin Summer. How we doing? You know, that's pretty good. Sometimes we, you know, we ask for the second one, but that's pretty good. What a beautiful night it has turned out to be. I thought we were going to really earn the name Sizzlin Summer with how today was going, but man, it feels great out. If we haven't had a chance to meet or it's your first time out, a special welcome. My name is Adler. I'm one of the pastors here, and we are here to glorify the name of Jesus with everything that we do. And wanted to share just a really quick story that many of you got to experience. If you got some food today and noticed that it was paid forward for you, that was somebody here that did that for you. Yeah, you can give a round of applause for them. So thank you for that generosity. They came up to us at the end of last service and wrote a check for what we typically do, which is about $3,400 a week. So we wanted to bless you guys. They wanted to bless you, and we were glad to just be able to see the happy faces as you got to enjoy that. So, all right, here's your reminder. We're turning this place into a sanctuary, which means that we are putting our focus, our gaze, and all of our attention on Jesus. And so I encourage you to minimize your distractions. So, cell phones, anybody? Do you turn it off? Do you even consider turning it off? I encourage you to turn it off. Turn off your cell phone right now. If you've got little ones with lots of wiggling energy, I encourage you to keep them with you for their safety and the safety of others. But mostly it is because we want there to be no obstacle in the way of our worship. We just want to get out of the way and let God do his thing. Amen? So we're going to hear God's word. We're going to see some incredible expressions of gifts tonight, and we're going to celebrate baptism. We're so glad you're here. I invite you to stand. Go ahead and stand as we begin to worship. Precious God, I just thank you for this place, this space, this time. God, I pray that our eyes and our hearts would be focused on you, and you would speak to us tonight, God, in a powerful way, that someone here would experience you for the first time, even if they don't expect it. We love you, Jesus, and it's in your name we pray. Amen. Let's worship.
All right, let's clap our hands, all you people. Shout unto God with a voice of triumph. Let's put your hands together. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Let's sing it out. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon. Strength will rise. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong.
Forevermore. From us. Amen. We look to you this evening. Thank you. Thank you for the gathering of your people here. We bless your name. We exalt you. We thank you for your desire to be with your people. Thank you for being here with us this evening. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Up in church and tell them where I'm hurt, tell them secrets I got and the temptations of flirt. They told me it's a safe place, hospital for sinners, not a museum for saints, yeah. But when I tell them where I'm at, they tell me where I ain't, when all I needed was someone to hear about my shame. Can anybody hear me? Can I say confess, but some are better unsaid. Try to watch my heart, a wellspring of life, but then the waters got dark. I got addicted, conflicted. I wish that I did so much different, but now it's just how it is. Is this just how it is? Can I say?
the truth we need to hear tonight, that if you hear nothing else, and I hope you hear a lot more, but if you hear nothing else, remember these three words. Grace is greater. Grace is greater. It's greater than anything that you've ever experienced in your life. It's deeper, it's more powerful, and it's life-changing. In the book of Mark, chapter 5, we read a story about a man who is possessed by 2,000 demons. And for most of us, we would look at a man like that and say, that man is too far for grace. That man's too lost. That man has too much going on. You see, this man, Jesus appears to him. Jesus appears. He sails through a storm, saves his disciples from drowning, arrives on the other side. This man comes running down the hill covered in scars, but Jesus didn't see the scars. Jesus didn't see the scars that had covered this man that he had caused to himself. No, instead of scars, he saw a son. He saw his child that he crafted, that he formed in his mother's womb, and he saw him for the man that he created him to be. And he saw that he was consumed by evil, this man who was filled with demons, and Jesus Christ, in a moment with a word, set him free. You see, grace was greater than those scars that had consumed this man's body and his identity. Grace was greater than the sin that had filled him, that had consumed his whole life. And tonight, if you are on this lawn, I want you to hear this truth, that grace is greater. It's greater than the sin that may have taken over your life that you think is keeping you from God. His grace is greater. If you came onto this lawn tonight and you've got scars from your past, things that you've done to yourself or have happened to you, and you carried it onto this lawn, I want you to hear the truth that grace is greater than your scars. Or maybe you're like the disciples in the very beginning of the story who were there sailing through a storm and they call to God and they say, Jesus, don't you care if we drown? And maybe you're like those disciples where you look at your life, you see the struggle, you see the turmoil, you see the storm, and you're saying, God, don't you care if I drown? And Jesus sees you. He knows you by name, and he is the one that is the calmer of all storms because his grace is greater than whatever storm you're going through. So tonight, if you hear nothing else, hear this from God's word. His grace is greater than your sins, your scars, and your storm. Whatever you think may keep you from the love of Christ, he and his grace are greater. Hear that truth tonight, because it's a truth that changed my life. So many years ago, when I was a lost 11-year-old kid, his grace met me in my storm. His grace met me in my sin. His grace met me with all the scars I had been carrying, and he said, I can heal you. I can set you free. That's the truth I want you to hear. Tonight, if that spoke to you in some way, if you know you need to make a decision to follow Jesus, tonight's the night to make that decision. If you need someone to pray with you, there's so many people here who would love to pray with you. If you would just need this reminder constantly in your life, stop by our table over by the Charity Water tent and grab a copy of this picture that it might remind you that grace is greater. Guys, God loves you. He has a plan for you. He has so much more in store than you have in mind. Trust in his grace because his grace is greater. Thanks so much.
Well, hey, everybody, how we all doing? So thanks so much, Tucker. Tucker Rocky grew up in our church. Some of you kind of grew up with Tucker doing all the skits in children's ministry. And you could see at a young age that he had this gift inside of him. I'm so proud of him because as a teenager, he took this concept of painting and he took it up and down the East Coast, raising all his own support as a young dude. And God has really blessed him. Now he travels the country painting freedom. Again, stop by the merch booth. He has a website. After the service, really encourage him. He's doing great things for God, and we're so excited he's here. Hey, I'm going to introduce Larry Moody, our speaker, in a couple minutes. Let me get you guys up to date on a couple things. If you've been to Sizzling Summer, or maybe it's your first time, we aren't raising any money. We're not taking any offerings this summer. But what we're asking you to do is to give to a ministry we really believe in called Charity Water. Up on the screen, you'll see a QR code. You can go to their site. There's a Calvary Chapel portion called The Spring where you can donate, and they're tracking what we're doing. Now, let me give you the update. So far, you've raised $52,000 for Charity Water. Now, that's good, but it's not enough, okay? We want to get to 100K by the end of the summer. And remember, Charity Water, Scott Harrison was here a couple Sundays ago. Charity Water isn't just about you giving $37 a month or a one-time gift. It's about you getting creative, like giving up your birthday. Go on Charity Water's site. You can give up your birthday and generate income. Let me tell you a guy who's doing something like this. This is so cool. He emailed me this week, and he said, Pastor Bob, just a quick note to tell you how moved I was by the talk from Scott Harrison about Charity Water. I signed up for the monthly donation for the spring and also decided to sponsor my own well. I chose Odisha, India, and I'm going to raise $10,000 through fundraisers with my ballroom dance studio. I always wondered and prayed about how to connect my business, my dance business, with something God would approve of. Then I heard Scott speak, and I knew that that moment had come to pass. We kick off the fundraiser later this week. Thank you for bringing Scott to CC Delco. Yeah. Go on the Charity Water website. There are kids under 10 years old that have raised 30 grand. So we're not done yet, guys. 52,000. We got to get to 100. What's Charity Water? They bring clean drinking water. They have brought it to 16 million people. We're trying to raise that up. Over a billion people on this planet suffer from clean drinking water. How will they ever hear the gospel? So thanks for all your effort. We're not done, but I think we'll get there, and we'll take it all the way through the summer as we go inside. Hey, bad news. Next week is the last sizzling summer, right? Now, we're going to have our 30th anniversary out in the lawn in October, but we'll get you up to speed on that. Luke Lefevre will be here next week. Now, here's what's interesting. Larry Moody, who I'm about to introduce, is our oldest speaker this summer. Larry, 75. Luke Lefevre is our youngest speaker, 26 years old. Let me tell you, this 26-year-old guy is doing great things for God. You can't miss Luke Lefevre. Come out. Let's make it the best final sizzling summer we ever had. You guys all up for that? Okay. One last thing. Sunday morning, we're in Summer in the Psalms. This Sunday, my son Mike will be here, Psalm 66. Someone spoke a prophetic word over him. Psalm 66 means a lot to him. You want to come out and hear Mike Sunday. It's going to be special. It's going to be powerful. I'm so glad Larry Moody accepted our invitation tonight. I've known Larry. I've golfed with Larry for a couple years now. He's been in ministry for 50 years. Started at Luke Lefevre's age, and he's still in the game. He's going to die on the stage. Not tonight. That's not prophetic. He's going to die doing ministry. I'm confident of that. I'm not going to tell you all that Larry's done. He's worked for Walk Through the Bible and Search Ministries. He was the head chaplain of the PGA Tour for 35 years, now the Champions Tour for 6 years. But here's the greatest thing I can say about Larry Moody. Off the stage, he's the greatest encourager I've ever met. Affable, winsome, encouraging. You have a bad day, hang around Larry Moody. You'll have a better day. Loves God, loves people. Larry, would you come and join us at Sizzling Summer? Thank you.
I resemble that. Very much so. What a privilege to be here. This is my first Sizzling Summer. It is really a privilege to be here with you. I want to talk tonight about the Visited Planted. I watched the bipartisan, if there is such a thing, congressional hearing today on UFOs. Very interesting. And they're ever wondering if we've ever been visited from outside. And I wanted to just raise my hand and say, woo, we have. His name was Jesus. he did come. He did. I want to share with you tonight what has been going on the PGA Tour over the years. There have been some incredible turning to Jesus from where they were. I want to tell you about Scott Simpson. Scott Simpson was the rocker, USC, twice NCAA champion in golf. Scott won the U.S. Open in 1987, and there goes the word. Oh, I got it. But he went to USC. That's the University of Spoiled Children. And when Scott came out to the PGA Tour, Scott would laugh at anybody that would go to the PGA Tour Fellowship, which is their non-denominational service. He'd walk by and say, "Suckers, I can't believe you believe that stuff." When I came out in 1981, he was invited to an open forum where he could come ask any question he wanted about God and life. See, he and his wife were planning on starting a family. And she said she was a believer in God and a believer in Jesus. And Scott didn't want to have anything to do with that for his kids. So he says, "Yeah, I'll come to that thing you do. I have been a follower of Jesus enthusiastically since I was 15 years old. I had become a skeptic because I had an atheist science teacher who had had a great influence on my life. My parents had trusted Christ when I was 5. We went to church every time the door was open. But Dr. Snellgrove had pretty much convinced me that that was for uneducated people. A new pastor came into our little town, Manahawkin, New Jersey, which is by Long Beach Island, if you don't know where Manahawkin is. Surf City, Beach Haven, Ship Bottom. And he was a soil chemist who had come to Christ his last year in college, went away to seminary, and we were the first church there in Manahawkin that he took. So I asked my parents, could I go see him? They said, "Yeah, sure." They didn't know I had double motive. See, Earl was an accomplished surfer, and I wanted to learn to surf. But I did want to know the answers. How in the world can you as a scientist believe in God? He began to disciple me, also taught me how to surf, and the guy who lived in the house in front of him, a guy by the name of Ron Domina. And Earl taught both of us how to surf on Long Beach Island. Ron Domina started a little company called Ron John Surf Shop. The very first one was in Ship Bottom, New Jersey. He didn't know any more about surfing than I did. I watched his wife design that logo on their dining room table. But Earl told me that if I would examine the person of Jesus Christ, he said, the jugular vein of Christianity, if you can disprove this, you can disprove Christianity, was the resurrection. We met through my high school years, and I determined I didn't want to do anything but share that kind of truth with others. So I really look forward to Scott Simpson asking me the questions. Ken Bowen and I wrote a book many years ago called I'm Glad You Asked. It deals with the 12 basic objections people have to Christianity. Why we say, I'm glad you asked? Because you should never retreat from those questions. It's a great opportunity to let people know what a difference Jesus Christ can make in their life. Well, I've never had a hard rocker from Southern California as obnoxious as Scott. But for 3.5 years as a genuine truth seeker, he could come to no other conclusion than that Jesus Christ was who he said he was. There was another fellow, you've probably never heard of him unless you're a golfer, Bernhard Langer from Germany. Scott never went to church. He said, what of a waste of a good golf tee time. Bernhard never missed. He was an altar boy. He went 3 and 4 times a week. Bernhard Langer and Scott Simpson had something in common. Neither one of them were going to heaven. Both of them were headed to hell. Scott came to the place where he received Jesus Christ as his Savior and Lord in May of 1984, he invited my wife, Miss Ruthie, where are you? Would you stand just and wave at the folks? I tell everyone that's my girlfriend, because she is. We met our freshman year in college, dated for 4 years. We've been married for 53. I am one of the most blessed men on the planet. That lady is still my best friend. The ministry I've been able to do has been because God gave me a woman that is as flexible as that lady is flexible. Scott prays to receive Christ. He invites Ruthie and I to join him at a place in Georgia, just a little tournament called, the Masters, that's it. And we went. Scott played very well, but in 1985, the winner was Bernhard Langer. It was the first time Bernhard had won, and after he won, they ushered him into Butler Cabin, and there in Butler Cabin, Bernhard used the name of Jesus as a swear word. He said, I made the turn at number 10, and I looked up, and Curtis Strange, geez, he was 4 shots ahead. I'm not going to use the Lord's name in vain. But he did. And I looked at Scott, and I said, wouldn't it be fun someday if Bernhard Langer used the name of Jesus a different way? We got down on that yucky shag carpet in Augusta, Georgia, and prayed that someday Bernhard Langer would be open to the gospel. As Bernhard tells the story, he woke up the next morning ranked number one in the world. He had won 7 times on 5 continents. He said, they lied to me. He looked at his wife and said, I'm empty. I don't feel fulfilled. Number one in the world, 7 wins in 1 year. And he says, we got to pack up and go to Hilton Head and start all over again. He had already planned a practice round with Bobby Clampett, who had come to a personal relationship with Jesus Christ the year before. He's sharing with Bobby that he is empty. And Bobby says, well, I know what fills that hole. It's Jesus. Why don't you come to the Bible study this week? Well, I don't know. He said some other expletives about not having gone to Bible studies. And he says, I'll talk to Vicky. They talked about it, and you should have seen Scott Simpson's eyes at Hilton Head in Morris Atowski's townhouse when Scott Simpson walked in. I mean, when Bernhard Langer walked in. Scott went and looked at me, looked at Bernhard, looked at me. I was teaching in the Gospel of John. I have taught out there now for 43 years. That's the only time I've taught through the Gospel of John. I was in John chapter 3. And this man who went to church 3 and 4 times a week, trying to earn his way to God, trying to be the best person he could be, heard for the very first time what Jesus told Nicodemus. You must, what? Be born again. By the way, churches use that term a lot. Jesus used it that once with Nicodemus, the religious leader. The next chapter, he tells the town tramp that he offers what? Living water. That's right. Somebody knows their stories over here. Well, Bernhard comes up after I was talking about if you're born once, you die twice. If you're born twice, you die once. Once a physical birth, once a spiritual birth. He came up to me and he says, Larry, my name is Bernhard Langer. Yeah, I know who you are. You just won the Masters. Yeah, I did. Yeah. He says, does it say born again in all the Bibles? I said, well, Bernie, if you can find yours, it'll say it in yours. But check the hotel tonight when you go back. Pull out the drawer. Look at it yourself. He says, I never heard that before. I said, Bernard, no matter how good you are, you're not good enough. And you'll never be so bad that the grace, as our brother just put up here, is not enough to cover you. He says, I'm so perplexed. I've never heard this. He says, I think about it. I said, I'll get you a Bible. He said, no, I'll get one. 2 months later, he prayed to receive Jesus Christ as his personal Savior. We were skiing in the Alps, and we were driving down a very scary mountain in a snowstorm. And I look over, and tears are running down Bernard's face. And I'm wondering whether I grab the steering wheel or not. And he says, Larry, I went to church all the time. Why did not my minister tell me I needed to have a spiritual birth? I said, Bernie, it wasn't because he was hiding it from you. He probably did not know it. He was not a student of the Word of God. Well, if you know Bernard Langer, Bernard Langer has set all of the records in the Champions Tour. He has now won 46 times, breaking Hale Irwin's record. He broke Jack Nicklaus's, Gary Player's record, and then 3 times he's broken his own record for majors as a champion. And every time, Bernard never misses an opportunity to tell people what a difference Christ has made in his life. I heard him speak to a bunch of businessmen in Birmingham 2 months ago where he shared, I was empty there with real, genuine enthusiasm. He doesn't fake anything. He is very serious when he's talking about his Lord. He said, but the day I prayed to receive Christ, I've never been empty since. And at 65 years of age, when you are not supposed to be winning tournaments, he won the U.S. Senior Open just the other week. Pretty amazing. Two men. Both had the same destiny without Christ. Who are you? Why are you here? Where are you going? You can resolve that answer. Look at the person of Jesus Christ as I did as a 15-year-old man, young man, immature man. Some would say at 75, I'm still there. I never wanted to play golf. I thought it was for old men. Now I are one. I didn't start playing till I started working with the pros. I'll never forget, if you ever play with me, you can come over and examine the ball that I have. I mark it specifically. Back when I was a 5 handicap, and I am no longer a 5, I was playing with Tom Lehman and Bernard Langer. And they gave me 10 strokes. Now, I'm telling you, I should have been beating them into the ground. After 7 holes, I was down 6. Bernard could tell you could fry an egg on my head. He came over, walked across the fairway, put his arm around me. He says, Larry, you're not good enough to get mad. Put a smiley on your ball. So if you come see my golf ball, it has 2 dots for eyes and a big old smiley. And now at a 13 handicap, I still enjoy golf. It's a game for you. You don't have to make a living for your family. They'd starve to death. What a privilege. I watched Payne Stewart for 17 years. He and I came out at the same time, wrestle and struggle with pain and suffering and issues that had gone on in his past. And finally came to the place where he prayed to receive Christ with his Sunday school teacher, Oral Hershiser. That was a little less than 2 years before his plane went down. He was wearing a bracelet that said WWJD. God is alive. He claimed it. He claimed to be God. He claimed to be the Creator. He claimed to be our Redeemer. How do I know that's true? Examine it for yourself. The jugular vein of Christianity, as I told you, is the resurrection. For 50 years, I have been willing to debate and argue with anyone who wants to talk about the resurrection. I have never found someone who has examined the evidence and found it wanting. I found people who couldn't be bothered to look at the evidence. You can get one of Gary Habermas's book on the resurrection. It's what caused an atheist by the name of Lee Strobel. When his wife became a Christian, Lee told me, "Larry, you know what I thought when my wife told me she became a Christian?" He's very emphatic. Lawyer type, you know, trained at Yale. Criminal writer. "What did you think?" He said one word, divorce. Said, "I'm not going to have her ruin my fun and all the things we've done." But he said, "I really did love her." So he went as a criminal investigative reporter. He's the one that caused Ford to have to own the Pinto being rear-ended and that they had manufactured a poor car in the Chicago Tribune. He got all kinds of awards and accolades for it. And he was going to do the same thing to this jugular vein of Christianity. Only thing is, after he examined it, he found that Jesus was exactly who he said he was. What does God offer you and me? He is available to everybody here in this room. Lawn. Wallless room. What does God offer? An eternal relationship with the living God. What's God's position? He's loving, for God so loved the world. And he's perfect. Matthew 5:48 talks about how we need to be perfect as our Father in heaven is perfect. How many of you are perfect on your own? Let me see your hands. Yeah, me neither. God is perfect. Our condition, we're sinful, flawed, make mistakes, and as good as you may be. And I had a judge in Maryland who showed me one day in his desk drawer how he kept a tally sheet on the people in the court system there in Maryland and how he was better than any of them. And I said, "As good as you are, Darryl, you're not good enough. Are you perfect?" "Nope." I said, "Well, then you're in trouble." Your sin separates you from God. For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And the wages of sin is what? Death. What Larry Moody deserves is hell. What Christ offered me by coming to the earth and paying the penalty for me was an eternal relationship with the living God. If you're a student of the Bible, you know from the time of Adam and Eve's sin and during the law, what did they have to do on the Day of Atonement? Make a sacrifice of what? A perfect lamb. To do what for the sins of Israel? Cover it. Our sin debt was so great that it can only have interest payments made. That's all they were doing. What'd they have to do the next year? Same thing. All that sacrifice did was cover the sins. How many of you have owned a home? How many of you own the home of the bank? For those first few years, what are you paying the most of? Interest, not principal. Jesus Christ comes and he says, I'm paying principal and interest. That's why John the Baptist looks at Jesus Christ and says, behold the Lamb of God that covers the sins of the world. Is that what it says? That's in the New Perverted Translation. He said, behold the Lamb of God who does what? Takes away the sin. Revolutionary thought for the Jewish nation. They kept wanting to cover the sin year after year after year. And when Christ died on the cross, what happened to the divider between the holy place and the holy of holies? Split right down the middle. Historians tell us you could put two teams of horses on either side of that curtain and you could not shred it. But after Christ's death, there was no need to make a covering for our sins. What do I have to do? No longer trusting in what I can do for God, trusting in what God did for me. Now, I've had 6 years of Greek and 3 years of Hebrew. I used to, 50 years ago, maybe 40 years ago, could just pick it up and read it. If you don't do it every day, you can't do it. I can do all the word studies I need to do in the original text. I can tell you this, from Old Testament to New Testament, what he says, and we have a word for it as theologians, double imputation. You know why we make up words like that? So you have to pay us, so we explain it to you. Double imputation means God took Jesus, who had no sin, and he took Larry Moody's sin and placed it on him. The double imputation, when I trust Christ and accept the free gift of his salvation, he places on me his perfection. God sees me through Christ. And one day will make me whole. What a privilege. At Payne Stewart's funeral, I had written an article for the Links letter using the word golf. G-O-L-F. And at Payne Stewart's funeral, it was used, and it said, God offers love and forgiveness. But when they finished Payne's memorial in Orlando after his plane had crashed, run out of fuel, the alternative to God offers love and forgiveness, if I reject it, golf means something else. Going out lost forever. You may think, I got all the time in the world. God only promises me today. At 75, I hope I can get a Caleb experience as an 80-year-old because I want to take more mountains for Christ. If you think about Ruthie and I, you could pray for us. We are involved in several couples' lives right now who are very close to the place where they're willing to no longer trust in what they're doing, but trust in what Christ has done for them. What a privilege to take the good news. The only ability God needs from you, those of you who already know Christ, is availability. I'm sure Bob's used that good one. Be available. Take that good news, because that's exactly what it is, good news. I've never had a friend say to me, "Boy, I wish you had never told me about Jesus." Not once. So you got a choice. You can place your trust in Christ and the work that he did and have an eternal relationship with the living God. But don't trust what I've just told you tonight. If you have doubts that Jesus was who he said he was, examine it for yourself. But don't be so foolish as to not examine it at all. This truth has eternal consequences, if I'm right. I'm betting my life on it. I'm going to close this in prayer. I want to share with you the prayer that Scott Simpson prayed, and I'm going to pray it, and you can pray it if this is what's truly in your heart. And then I'm going to have Pastor Bob come up. But this was the one that Scott prayed that night flying home to San Diego. On that May, after missing the cut at Memorial Tournament. If you can say these words in your own heart and you're ready to make that transfer of trust from yourself to him, I'd encourage you to pray the prayer along with me. Dear God, I admit that I'm a sinner, and I understand that my sin separates me from you. I believe that Jesus, being God, paid the penalty for all my sins when he died on the cross and rose from the dead. I want to place my trust in you, Jesus, as my Savior. Thank you for loving and forgiving me and giving me the gift of eternal life. In Jesus' name, amen. Pastor Bob?
Thanks so much, Larry. You know, we like to say that Sizzling Summer is a safe place for a very dangerous message. We're outdoors. It looks like a country fair. But I'm so honored that Larry told the truth tonight when he said there were two men, one religious, one non-religious, who were not going to heaven. It's a dangerous message. We have one life. And we don't know what tomorrow brings. LeBron James' son, cardiac arrest. His whole life ahead of him, 18 years old, cardiac arrest. The Bible says God holds our breath in his hands. We're not trying to scare anybody. But we're trying to love you into the kingdom. And it doesn't have to be at 50. It could be at 15 like Larry Moody. It could be at 11 like Tucker. Because then you could spend your life changing the world. We're going to enter into a ministry time here where we do three things. Number one, do you want to accept Jesus Christ? Are you one of those people? I was at 21 on a college campus. I had never heard the term, you must be born again. Had no idea what it meant. Had no idea it was in the Bible. Had never read the Bible. Do you want to accept Christ in your heart? That's first. Second, you want to be baptized. Some of you are like, well, I was baptized, yeah, but everybody in the Bible that was baptized had a conversion. It was their decision. So if you want to be baptized, it means you know Christ, but you've never publicly, before everyone, said, I belong to the family of God. That's number two. And number three, maybe you need prayer. Maybe you're empty. Maybe life is hard, difficult. Maybe you're going through some tremendous circumstance. We don't want anybody to rush into anything. We have trained prayer counselors here. We have pastors, teachers, elders. We want to help you on your spiritual journey. I believe Sizzling Summer was born of God for significant spiritual moments like this. So as everyone prays, I'd like anyone who wanted to accept any of those three invitations to walk right down this aisle, the center. You can come around this way, come around that way. I ask for all the elders and our prayer team. We'll meet you right where you are. Larry Moody's going to be here. And we want you to have an encounter with God. I ask everybody to be prayerful, considerate. Some of you have had your moment. Maybe it's someone else's moment tonight. If you want to accept Christ, if you want to be baptized, if you need prayer, come on down. Moses, can you lead us a little in a song?
Yeah, let's do it. Let's sing of the goodness of God.
And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness.
The Bible says the angels rejoice in heaven. What are you guys doing? Come on. Right down here in the center, you can come to my right. Thanks for coming down, guys. Give them a hand. Hey, Adler, why don't you come on up and we'll find out what God's doing here.
All right, so this is Elena, and like many folks we talk to, it's like we don't speak in front of crowds a lot, so we're going to keep it brief, but Elena and I had a chance to talk earlier this week. You know that a lot of stuff's going on in life, right? But why don't you just tell us, so why are you here today?
To publicly proclaim that Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior.
Yeah, amen. Amen. Elena, would you say, is that different than being brought up in church?
Yes. I have a heart for Christ now. The Lord's definitely changed my heart. I have a hunger for His Word. I've started a Bible study, and I have community in Christ. Yeah.
And that's all the work of God, not on us, right? Right. Awesome. Well, let's go on into the pool, okay?
Lena, that's so great to hear your testimony. You believe Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Upon your profession of faith, I am so honored to baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
All right, Kristen. Kristen's up here with us. So this wasn't planned, right? So why are you here?
I'm here because I have accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, and I just want to do it in public and have everybody know. It's hard for me because I'm very afraid of crowds and everything. But
amen. Amen. Well, we're excited to celebrate you with you, Kristen.
So you're not dressed for tonight, so I know, God, anything about tonight that moved you or...
No, it's just been a long time coming, great. And then I just finally wanted to do it.
Excellent. Believer in Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Upon your profession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
All right, this is Tomas.
How you doing tonight?
Never been better.
Okay, tell everybody what's going on.
God brought me here.
Physically tonight, or?
I guess. Yeah.
So there's got to be a little backstory.
I went to camp, and I had an experience with God, and I want to proclaim it.
How old are you?
18.
What was your experience?
I understood His love.
18 years old, you got your whole life ahead of you. I don't want this week to go by. I really don't. Father, I pray for this man. I pray for what you've done in his heart. God, I pray that your word would fill him. Lord, I pray that you would set him on a path that he would never look back. I pray that he would remember this night that the old man was left in this pool and there's a new life that you're going to live through him. And upon his profession of faith, I want to baptize him in the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen. I've never had that request before. He said, leave me down as long as you can. By the way, I think the world record is 5 minutes.
We're not going for any of those tonight. We're not going for any of those. This is Joshua.
Hi, Joshua. How you doing? Tell us what's going on tonight.
Yeah, so I've grown up in a Christian household my whole life, but I've never really felt God's word. I always used to understand what people told me, but I never really felt that tug. And this past week, I met an amazing group of people, and God showed me who he was through them. And I've struggled with temptation, sin, and addiction, and I've really figured out that there's no worldly solution to any of these, and the only way to do it is through God. And I just want to surrender my life and start this chapter with God. So.
Oh, that is so... For those of you who wonder whether you were coming tonight or not, is that worth it? Oh, my goodness, you've made my day. Believer in Jesus Christ?
Yes.
On your faith, I'm going to pray that you're a changed man in the name of Jesus. Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit come all over you.
All right, this is Ava. Ava, you also did not plan on coming up here, so tell us what's going on.
I've known God for a while, but I just want to publicly declare this decision. I was baptized as a baby, grew up in church, but it just feels right.
Do you believe that Jesus is your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Do you want to follow him all the days of your life?
Yes.
We're going to baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I'm up here with Wes, and Wes is a part of our J Kids, has been thinking about this and praying about it. Wes, why are you here today?
I want to be baptized. I accepted God as my Savior 3 weeks ago.
Amen. Amen. Whether 11, how old are you, Wes?
12.
12 years old. 12 years old. And you saw Tucker up here. His journey started at 11. We're excited for you. Why don't you go ahead and enter into the pool, okay? All right, Sarah, so you're Wesley's mom. Why are you here today?
So I accepted Christ as Lord of my life when I was a teenager, and I've never been publicly baptized. So when Wesley came home from camp and told me that he asked Jesus to be his Lord and Savior and said, Mom, have you ever been baptized? All the fears and the convictions that I've been wrestling with for the past few years on this lawn and in life just kind of hit me. So I'm ready to take this step of obedience and be all in for Christ.
Amen. Amen. Why don't you?
Yeah. I love that phrase, all in. What camp?
He goes to Camp Sackinac.
Nice.
Yeah.
Nice. Awesome. Look, sometimes you can't make a decision in one night, right? It takes a while. So proud of you.
This is Betty Ann.
Hi, Betty Ann. How are you? Are you a little nervous? Okay. Look, I think what you're going to share might help somebody out there. So tell us what's happening.
I've been a follower of Jesus my whole life and was baptized as a baby, accepted Jesus at a Methodist church with my mom as a little girl. I still remember it, sitting in the pew, and I felt that, but have never really publicly proclaimed my love for the Lord, and just I want to continue walking with him and having him be the center of everything I am.
Give me something I can pray for you about.
For my family, my family, that we all stay connected and can love God together and walk with him, all of us.
God, you're the God of families, and Lord, early in Scripture, we see a man and a woman bearing children, and Lord, we just pray for all the families on this lawn. I pray for my sister's family. God, I've seen so many people saved in families, and in my family, sometimes 30 years. So God, be with our families. Bless my sister tonight, and upon her confession of faith, I baptize her in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
It's Joe.
What's up, Joe? So I know you're you got a lot of fans out here. Yeah, you got a big following. Why tonight?
I've been like searching for the last couple, like 4 years, and I just eventually like realized that it was true.
So, look, I'm way down the line, so. Help me with what a four-year search looks like.
I don't know if it's that deep, but it's just, you know, it's very profound that God would come down and save someone.
And in all reality, listen, what Joe's trying to figure out is life, right? He's raising a Christian family, but he's looking at life. He's looking at TV. He's looking at movies. He's looking at the world, trying to put it all together. And he put it all together. So I'm excited what God's going to do. Follower of Jesus Christ?
Absolutely.
Father, it's my privilege to baptize Joe. Lord, I pray that he would look out on this lawn and remember this night when temptation comes his way. When the love of money and lust and power comes, that he would know that he who's in him is greater. And Lord, upon his profession of faith, I baptize him in the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit.
This is Keenan. So, Keenan, we got to have a good conversation over there, but why are you here today? Because this wasn't planned, right?
Not at all. I'm here because my great-grandma, she's going through a whole lot right now. We don't really know how long she has left. I'm doing this so God can guide me through this, and I can help my family get through this as well.
And yeah, I know that there's a lot of hard stuff going there. You were telling me over there that you've been reading the Bible and you've believed in Jesus for a while, right?
Yes, all my life.
So today, with kind of the expectation, knowing that all things come to an end, today's the day?
Yes.
100% sure. You want to make this declaration today?
Yes.
All right.
So, Keenan, I just want to applaud you for being a real man, because I know a real man means a lot out there, and it's not real. But somebody that wants to stick up for his family and get them through a tough time and acknowledge they love God, that's a real man. A real man tells all these people that you believe in Jesus. God, I just pray that you would guide Keenan. Lord, that's his prayer, that you would lead him and guide him. I pray, Lord, whether it's through the word or street signs or an audible word, Lord, that you make him the man you've called him to be. Upon his profession of faith, I baptize in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
All right, this is Brennan. Brennan, you said it so clearly to me just then. Why are you here today?
Because I'm ready to give my life to Jesus Christ.
Amen. Amen. Well, let's celebrate.
By the way, thanks for staying, everybody. This is awesome. Thanks for just beholding this. It's so special. Man, that's a bold declaration. Jesus Christ, your Lord and Savior?
Absolutely.
On your profession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.
All right, this is Shirley. Shirley, I know we have a lot we could say, but why are we here today?
So I gave my life to Jesus when I was 13. I was an elder of my church for 6 years, but I've never been baptized. And all the years I've been coming here on Wednesdays, the devil's kept me in my chair. And I finally decided last week, no more.
No more. No more. Now, Pastor Bob, this is our left arm.
Can I just say one more thing?
Yeah.
I just want to say that two of my great nephews and my niece were just baptized here.
Yeah. Amen.
Every time Larry does it, I think wah-wah geese are flying over. I thought you were gonna do that in your message. So there's no magic about baptism. It's an outward reality, what's already happened in someone's heart. But I love that phrase, I've never been baptized and the devil was holding me there. There's some kind of word that he speaks to us that it doesn't matter, but it does matter. You know why? This is the first step of obedience. Because if we can do this, we could do every other thing he calls us to. So I'm proud of you. I know there's something wrong with your arm. Any special instructions for me? Okay. So I'll work with the other side. Okay. I'm more gentle than I'm given credit for. Are you a believer in Jesus?
Absolutely.
Upon your profession of faith, I baptize you very gently in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.
It's perfect. All right, we have another gentleman making our way here. Who I don't know if you know the Gorbys. Anybody heard of the Gorbys? Family in our church. This is Frank Gorby. Hey, Frank, so we're so glad you're here.
You know Taylor's a Gorby, right?
I know. Yeah. The clan is expanding. And you're late for the party. Frank, why are you here?
After watching my brother dying for 6 months, and finally towards the end, he said, Frank, he says, I'm not afraid. I'm not scared. He says, I know where I'm going. I'm going to see Jesus. And I thought I'd come along.
Do you believe that Jesus is your Lord and Savior?
I do.
Do you believe that he died that you might be with Christ forever?
Yes, I do.
Then it's our privilege to celebrate with you and the rest of the Gorbys out there. I don't know. What do you need from us?
So this is the oldest Gorby I've ever baptized, for sure. 73, yeah. It's never too late, right? Believer in Jesus Christ?
Yes, I am.
Upon your profession of faith, my privilege to baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. What's your name? Oh, Monica. Yeah, my wife's Monica. This is Monica, everybody. Tell us what's going on.
So I was raised Catholic. My entire family is Catholic. Nicole and our two other kids were raised Catholic. And I've been coming here for a year and a half now, thanks to Nicole and Emmy. And I've met so many beautiful, incredible people and lovers of God. And I prayed the sinner's prayer with your Monica in February, and this was not planned, but here I am, and I just want more. I just want more of God.
Praise God. Wow. So my wife was here and then had to attend to a family matter. I can't believe it. But I'll go home and tell her. I'm so proud of you. I'm so excited for your journey. God, I pray for Monica. Lord, I pray she would grow by leaps and bounds. I pray when she reads your word, you would speak to her. Lord, be her shepherd in good times and bad times. Make her to lie down in green pastures, still waters. Comfort her soul, Lord, even though she walks through the valley of death. Upon her profession of faith, we baptize in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
All right, this is Haley, and we were, I'm just so glad we were talking and praying before the service. Why are you up here today?
I just want to accept Jesus into my life.
Amen. Do you believe that Jesus died on a cross for your sins?
Yes.
Do you believe that he was risen by the Spirit of God so that we might be with God forever?
Yes.
It is our privilege to celebrate with you in baptism.
So for some of you, this might be why you came. Everybody see her shirt? Pray more, worry less. That's a really good phrase. I like that. Upon your profession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
All right. This is Kendall. Can everybody give a round of applause for Kendall? Yeah. Kendall's a part of our J Kids. Mom serves in our nursery. Kendall, why are you here today?
Because I love Jesus so much, and I believe he died on the cross for all of our sins. And
do you want to serve him all the days of your life?
Yeah,
we'll just keep it at that. And maybe dance. We might dance with him, too. That's awesome. We're going to celebrate with baptism here. And I pray that you remember this day as a special day where the journey gets a little bit deeper and the flame never goes out. Can you do that? All right.
Lord, we thank you for the little children. Lord, we thank you for their innocence. This is the way we were made, Lord, before sin wrecked the world. I pray for my sister, Lord, that you would give her some kind of holy ignorance, Lord, to some of the really bad things out there, that you would keep her from all those things. God, just be a light unto her world. Lord, as she grows, may she grow to be a wonderful woman of God. And remember this day where she was baptized as a believer in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. What are we going to do next week? Hi, Amber.
Hi, how are you?
Tell me what's going on.
Nothing. I knew Jesus since a child. I was baptized as a child, but I didn't truly know what it meant. So now that I'm older, I came with my husband.
Common story. So proud of you. Do you believe in Jesus Christ?
Yes.
Upon your profession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit.
All right, this is Angel. This is Amber's other half. We got a really nice conversation beforehand, but Angel, why are you here today?
I want to give my life to God in front of everyone. Yes.
Yeah. Expectant dad?
Yes.
dealing with loss of mom recently.
Correct.
A lot of stuff. I just want to pray over you before you go in the pool. And Pastor Bob, I'll pray over you too, okay? Precious Father, God, I just thank you for this man. Lord, I thank you for the moment that we get to celebrate here with his bride. God, I just pray over future fathership. God, I pray that you would make it clear the next step beyond obedience, God, into headship of a family that's developing, Lord. God, I pray that you would fill him with joy, Lord, that his morning would be turned into dancing. God, we keep our eyes focused on you and all that you will do. And I just thank you for today. I pray that it would be a special moment of many to come. In Jesus' name, amen. This is Jackson.
Hey, Jackson. How you doing? All right. Tell us what's happening.
So I'm a new Christian, only a few months, but I felt the Lord do so many things in my life over the past few months. I'm getting ready to go back to school. I know that I'm going to need him every step of the way.
So you got to find, where are you going to school?
I go to Clemson.
Clemson. All right. So I'm sure, Larry, Clemson have a great intervarsity. Yeah, so you get down there, you crew, intervarsity. Here's the deal. This is the secret. You go there the first Friday, you'll have 40 people you know. What happens in college, the reason people drink and the party is they don't know anybody and they want to fit in. I played basketball, so I knew 12 guys right away. You'll know 40 people right away, and they'll do a retreat in September so you all get to know each other. You're not going to make it if you don't go there, all right? But this is a great first step. And I'm so excited. Upon your profession of faith, I'm going to baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.
All right, this is Skylar. Skylar, I'm so proud of you that you're here, and I know you're shy, okay? But just talk to me like you did right over there. Do you believe that Jesus is your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Do you believe that he died on a cross for you?
Yes.
Do you believe that he was risen from the dead, unlike any other person, so that we might be with God forever?
Yes.
And do you want to follow him?
Yes.
And that's why you're here?
Yes.
All right. We'll keep it nice and simple. Head on in. This is Barbara. Barbara, why are you here today?
I was baptized when I was a baby, and I've always believed in Jesus as a child, and I just wanted to publicly accept Jesus Christ as my Savior.
Amen. Awesome. Amen to that.
Barbara, my prayer is God's going to give you a little boost, right? Little rocket fuel for your next leg of the journey, all right? Are you a believer in Jesus Christ?
Yes.
On your profession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
Can we all stand together and one last time thank the Lord for a spectacular night? So church doesn't end when we leave here. We take God with us. Give God 6 days. Tell people about his love and bring them back next Wednesday. And we'll do this all over again. We can only baptize who you bring and who you're in relationship. Almost everybody tonight shared someone else that was involved in their life. May the Lord bless you and keep you all the days of your life. Thank you, Larry Moody. Thank you, Tucker. Thanks for all the staff. Thanks for the free food. God bless you all. We'll see you next time.